Chairman of the Club, it is my great pleasure to introduce tonight a visitor from across the water. I'm going to get my notes out, if you'll excuse me.
Oh, really? Excuse me just a moment. Here, then. And I need my glasses.
Now, we have tonight Professor Marek Chodakiewicz, who is a Polish-American, so he's been in the States for 32 years, has actually been here before, last year, and quite some time ago, I understand, when he was quite young. However, it's the first time I've seen him here. Now, he's a Polish-American historian, specializing in East Central European history of the 19th and 20th century. He currently holds the Kosciuszko Chair of Polish Studies at the Institute of World Politics in Washington, and Washington DC, and has authored a number of books on Poland and associated topics. And he lives in Washington DC too. Now, the talk is about he's actually Polish freedom and the democratic traditions from the Anglo-Saxon perspective. Being an Anglo-Saxon, this is something I might appreciate. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I've done enough waffling. All I will say is that after the lecture has finished, there is a chance to talk. There will be wine on the table outside. And as I mentioned, probably those of you who read the advertising, a voluntary donation of a fiver or thereabouts would be quite nice to contribute towards the cost of the wine, which will be ready when we're finished. Now, this lecture will be 45 minutes, an hour. There'll be a chance for questions afterwards. But I'm now going to hand over to Marek. Marek, over to you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. Thank you very much for coming to listen to me, and I am promptly disabused of the microphone.
Thank you very much, Professor. Just before I pass the microphone to the Professor, I'd like to give you a bit of background for today's lecture. This is the first lecture in the 6th lecture series entitled Polish Parliamentarism and Democratic Traditions. This year we celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Round Table Talks and the beginning of restoration of the democratic Polish state, and we thought it's a good opportunity to remind world about Polish contribution to the events of 1998 and 1990, but also to remember that the fact that the Polish road to freedom actually started in the early 15th century. And the aim of the program of those 6 lectures is to place Polish democratic traditions in the mainstream of reflection of European democratic traditions. The project is carried out by the Center for Political Thought in Krakow with the support of the Polish Research Center of the Jagiellonia University in London and the City University in London. The project is co-financed by the Polish Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and you can find more information about the further lectures and more information about the topic on our website democracy.pl. Ognisko Polskie is one of the oldest Polish places in London, and it played a very important role during the Second World War. After the war, for 45 years, it was one of the key places in UK where the social and the intellectual life of the Polish emigre was centered, and Poland fell under the Soviet rule in the years 1944 and 1945. And with this in mind, we thought there would be no better place to start our first lecture in Ognisko Polskie. And as the professor was introduced, the first lecture is entitled Polish Freedom and Democratic Traditions from the Anglo-Saxon Perspective. After the lecture, the professor will be happy to take questions. And now, without delay, I'll pass the microphone over to the professor. Please welcome Professor once again, please.
Thank you once again for coming out to meet with me and listen to me bore you to death. I apologize in advance because I'll be making twitches. This is to prompt the young lady who volunteered to go through the pretty pictures. Now, it's Sunday today, so it's pertinent. We'll be talking about freedom and Christianity in the Anglo-Saxon and Polish context, in particular, but freedom is a universal concept, so we will not particularize for a while. Now, when I told a friend of mine I was coming to London, she said, "What are you going to talk about?" I said, "Well, freedom." She said, "Well, I had a Greek boyfriend. He told me the Greeks invented everything." Because I also mentioned that we will discuss Poland's parliamentary tradition and England's legacy of freedom. "No, no, the Greeks invented everything." I said, "I beg your pardon. The Poles are not stuck up, they are obsessed. So my take will be the elephant in the Polish question, where I'm not going to claim that the Poles invented everything, even though some of you may want to criticize me very severely. Now, the topic is about freedom, so I jotted down, what is freedom? It's not license, but this would be a negative connotation. Life is not a party, because if life were a party, so freedom to do anything you want, the word party would be meaningless, and the word life too. Because if we party all the time, it's not pleasant. You have to stop sometime and rest. If life is a party, it's an ongoing party, it's not freedom. So it's license, and it's not something that I'm interested to talk to you about. So I think, for me, freedom is a gradual path to self-realization. Yes, it does sound Hindu. Freedom is about self-control. Freedom is doing what I want to do with responsibility. Freedom is being in charge of oneself. It may be a paradox, but that's how I see it. Freedom is naturally connected to free will, and freedom is connected to human dignity, at least in Western civilization. Where all of this come from? Well, it comes from Christianity. Christianity is a religion of love, that, in addition to that feeling, has brought the world quite a bit of violence in the name of love. But it is a religion of love. Christianity comes from Jesus Christ. It's the covenant of the Hebrews universalized. Christianity preaches that one ought to love one's enemy. That means it's a freak religion. Anthropologists have proven that each time a human being meets another, until quite recently, one wanted to kill or be killed. That's the reflex. There has been work done on Papua New Guinea, and the BBC had a very nice series about it. Kill. So Christianity is counterintuitive because it preaches love thy enemy. Love thy enemy more than yourself. Also, Christianity posits that there is no Greek, no Roman. We are all children of God. When the social Darwinists were riding high in Britain's universities, and the glitterati were running around with compasses measuring human heads, there was only one person who would dare to stand up, John Cardinal Newman, who said, "We are all children of God." So Christianity posits dignity of each individual soul. Dignity translates into egalitarianism of sorts, but it also translates into freedom, because if a human being has dignity, then each human being is capable of invoking freedom. In the Western tradition, the roots are firmly Christian. There is another, I should say, limiting circumstance, namely, render unto Caesar, or Caesar's. That means Christianity recognizes that civil authority or secular authority has a valid claim, and we must somehow accommodate it. unless it violates our conscience, our dignity, our freedom, that we can't take it no more, and we join Nigel Farage. And you, or do something. Christianity also was characterized by a missionary zeal from St. Paul, Shaul, who introduced a revolutionary gimmick. Namely, he said, well, women are usually interested in Christianity, but I'd like to attract guys, so let's forget about circumcision. And then he became a great Christian missionary all over the Roman Empire. Missionary activity to convert, and nothing encouraged more than women, in particular, women martyrs. All martyrs, but women martyrs were at the beginning, during early Christian days, particularly intrepid. Santa Perpetua is my favorite. She was a Roman patrician who was caught by the authorities worshipping Jesus Christ with her slaves. And the slaves were executed just like that at the circus. She, however, because she was a patrician, was given a chance to abjure, to apostatize, and she said no. So she was slowly hacked to pieces. I think she was 17 at the time. She spoke for religious freedom, for freedom of conscience. She was hardcore, Santa Perpetua was. What's the context of Christianity? Well, what eventually developed and reigned supreme in its most sublime form as Western Christendom consisted, in terms of theory, ideas, of Greek philosophy, in particular Aristotle, Roman Empire's legacy, institutions, law, both jus naturale and jus gentium, and various, if you go on more, and various other, here's more or less the Roman world and early medieval times, and various other devices. One of the most important accoutrements, or maybe foundations of freedom, was private property. If you have private property, that means you can decide for yourself. Feudalism, a form of government that was unique to Europe. Everywhere else we had patrimonial states where the heads of states, kings, emperors, and others decided. In feudalism, the lords obtained the right to private property. They would tell the sovereign, sire, we serve you. We render military service and you give us lands. We would like to bequeath the lands onto our progeny, give them to our children. We want the lands to be ours. Once the lords receive such rights, the knights ask for them and other warriors, then the burghers and the farmers. Eventually it trickled all the way down. There is no analogous movement without Western influence anywhere in the world. And this is something that the greatest of all Oxford dons, arguably Christopher Dawson, called the genius of Christianity. Christopher Dawson. Read him. He lived a long time ago, but he's very relevant. Christianity lived Western Christendom, operated in a context. The context was Byzantine Christianity, and the context was Islam. Whereas Islam can be briefly described as a hybrid, even a heresy of Christianity and Judaism, Byzantine Christianity is a special form of Christianity that developed differently because it stressed the idea of Caesaropapism. Unlike in the West, Caesar was also the Pope. Caesaropapism. That meant there was no differentiation between church and state. There was no space, autonomous space, where you as a human being could find if you found yourself at odds with the emperor. Unlike in the West. Can we move? Western Christendom, with its individualism, freedom, and private property, clashed from the very beginning from the ideas espoused by Eastern Christianity, Byzantine Christianity, and its Caesaropapism. It was Saint Augustine who posited that his universal, his world, was divided into the city of God and the city of man. In the city of God, human beings had autonomy. Hence, the very English, or actually universal Western, idea of asylum. That did not exist either in Islam or in Byzantine Christianity. I'm not even going to touch upon all other civilizations, but in Western Christendom, that is from the British Isles to the Eastern marches of Poland, you could run to a church from an emperor and or from a king or a local lord, and you were free to hide, like Quasimodo, for example. That's a sphere of freedom which stems from Christianity. Saint Thomas Aquinas added to it the ideas about just war. That means I am free to say, sire, by the way, no, this war is not just. I'm not going. Nothing like this in Byzantine Christianity or Islam or anywhere else. No reflex to provide institutional or moral or ethical framework for freedom, only in Christianity. St. Thomas Aquinas further taught us, by synthesizing Aristotle, the idea of approximating the truth. If I talk about freedom, I speak about absolutes. Otherwise, such concepts as freedom would make no sense. To obtain freedom, you have to believe that this is the truth. Not maybe, not sometimes, not Foucault, not postmodernism, not deconstruction, or I can enslave you all, because it's all relative. Well, it's not all relative. It is all truth. St. Thomas Aquinas is the one. In foreign relations, Christianity appeared in its most sublime form, arguably, at the Congress of Constance in 1414. The Bishop of Krakow, Paweł Sławomir, Paweł Wodkowicz in Polish, showed up before the mighty of the world, including the emperor, and said, "We shall not convert pagans with fire and sword, because we shall convert them with love." You should have heard the collective thud where everyone's jaw dropped. This was one of the most novel concepts in international relations, and it's directly from Christianity. It's also from the Polish tradition. Why? Well, the Saxons had been converted with fire and sword by the Franks. The Franks would herd the Saxons, Germans, Germanic tribes, on the riverbank, baptize them and slit their throats and throw them into the river in droves. Once the Saxons became Christian in such a fashion, they embarked on a crusade eastwards and attacked the Slavic tribes to the west. Once the people between the Elbe and the Oder River were Slavic, Lusatian Slavs, and beyond there were other tribes, including the Polani and so forth, the ancestors of modern-day Poles. The Saxons meted out fire and sword to them in the name of Christianity. There was no freedom. Oh, you know what the Poles did? They got hitched. The Polish prince got himself a babe from Prague. Yeah, with love. And the Poles became Christian. Nobody had to die. No fire and sword necessary. Later, 380 years or so later, the Poles applied the same method, almost 400 years, to the Lithuanians, the last pagans of Europe. The last pagans of Europe who experienced Christian love from the Teutonic Knights, who tried to convert them with the fire and sword. And the Poles? Well, the Grand Duke of Lithuania married the King of Poland. Yes, you've heard it right. The granddaughter of King Casimir the Great was crowned King of Poland because Poland had no Salic law, and uniquely for Slavic, Polish and Christian reasons, women could inherit. I don't know if you have heard the feminists beating the drums, how in the 20th century, or maybe at the end of the 19th, they miraculously produced equality and women in Holland, and even in England could start to inherit. Well, I have news for you. In Poland, women, and in fact all siblings, there was no primogeniture for a long time, could inherit. That's freedom too. Why? Because I can go ask you for a check for a scholarship, even if you're a woman. That means you have freedom. You have power. If we can go on. Well, that was Europe. Paulus Vladimir. And here you have Bartolomé de las Casas and Juan de Sepúlveda. Juan de Sepúlveda was a leading Aristotelian scholar. And Bishop Bartolomé de las Casas was the so-called apostle of the Indies. There was a disputation, if my memory serves me right, in 1534 at the University of Salamanca, in front of the royals. And Juan de Sepúlveda, taking the Aristotelian position, argued that some human beings are innate slaves. Aristotle said so, that some human beings were innate slaves. Aristotle never ever mentioned a race. So the Sepulveda said, well, the Indians, meaning Native Americans, and of course the African blacks, therefore they should be enslaved because they are innately, genetically slaves. Here's an explanation. In America, we describe innate slaves, we oftentimes refer to them as innate slaves, but we use a different term. We call them couch potatoes, you know, people who vegetate on the couch and flick TV channels. And then they die of a heart attack, but that's a different story. Yes, that's what Aristotle meant. That's why he never mentioned anything about human anthropology, ethnicity, or anything else. Juan de Sepúlveda was wrong. Bartolomé de las Casas stood up and said, this is wrong because we are all children of God. We have dignity, hence we have freedom. And he won. Why? Because the royals called themselves Reyes Muy Católico. They had no choice. If they were Catholic, Christian potentates, they had to rule in favor of the Christian position, not the pagan position. Right? Okay. And thus, you shouldn't be surprised that when the Spaniards captured various islands, first they ruled most of them in the Caribbean, at church, the Dominican fathers would stand up and threaten their congregations routinely for slavery. They would threaten them with hell. The Dominicans would say, you go to hell for keeping slaves and killing them. Strange? No. This is absolutely congruent with Christianity. Not that slavery, the peculiar institution, was anything weird. First recorded and deciphered hieroglyphs from Assyria and elsewhere talk about cargo, commodity, human beings to be sold thousands of years ago. So slavery has been around forever, and freedom has been around forever. And the genius of Christianity is that the most powerful, like the Las Casas, saw the evil that it was not the freak. That was not the freak. When Spartacus rebelled in the Roman Empire, he dreamt about establishing a state of free men who would keep Romans as slaves. When on Haiti, when the slaves rebelled there against the French, after winning their freedom, they immediately enslaved most of the population. So there were blacks and mulattoes keeping mostly black slaves, because they thought it was great. You know, now they were masters. Slavery, it has been around forever. The idea of freedom is extremely unusual. Only it's germinated since the beginning of Christianity, and it's taken a very long time to come to fruition. There were attempts to frame some kind of a universal system in which we could experience freedom and human dignity to the utmost. And there were two theoreticians, Francisco de Vitoria and Francisco Suarez, two Jesuits, that's before the Jesuits went left. Two Jesuits, they talked about a universal monarchy where freedom and human dignity would be realized, and the universal monarch would be the Pope. So I don't know how they were going to square it up, theocracy and the Augustinian division between the church and state, but that was one of the first proposals. It's all in the Christian doctrine. And finally, if you want to read a synthesis of Christianity and international order, the person to look up is Hugo Grotius, a Dutch learned man. He basically copied everything that had come before him, synthesized it, and presented it. Voila, here it is. Here is the origin of international law. And now a bit about Christianity and practice. Here is a map of some of the early heresies, actually, through the 3rd to the 14th centuries. Heresies threaten orthodoxy. The clergy were keepers of orthodoxy, in particular Rome. Why? Well, most of the sects you see here would like to collectivize private property, collectivize women, and make everybody equal except for the guru and his politburo. If it sounds Bolshevik, yes, but it's been around since the 3rd century. And the church saw this as a threat, not only to itself as an institution, perhaps the institution of Western Christendom, but also as a threat to human freedom. Nobody wants to be collectivized. If you doubt me, ask any Chinese who survived Mao, or any Cambodian who survived Pol Pot, or Ukrainian who survived Stalin's collectivization, or Russian for that matter. If we can go on. The church, therefore, established a little thing is missing, so we'll go back. Established the Inquisition, and the Inquisition gave us another freedom. Namely, for the first time in Western history, we learned how to cross-examine. Hitherto, till about 10th century or so, when the Dominicans came around, we had two types of court procedures. One was the trial by fire. That meant if I offended you, you would find the champion and we'd slug it out. If I won, it means I was right. A second judicial gimmick was to accuse a human being of sorcery, and that human being would be floated in the river. So we'd go to the river, break the ice, and dunk him, a wizard, or her, a witch, under the ice, and let her swim under the ice. If she floated and lived, then most certainly she was guilty, so she'd be burnt alive. If she didn't float, it meant that the accuser was a perjurer. And slight cases of perjury, like check kiting, were punished by branding with fire. More serious cases, like lying about an alleged witch, well, they entailed burning. So when the Inquisition was established, it was with a direct purpose to ferret out heresy by asking questions, because not everybody, most people accused of heresy or witchcraft were not. And when the Dominicans began questioning, positing syllogisms, which they learned from Aristotle and other philosophers of antiquity, they could establish again, as a bad word, the truth. So fewer people were floated or burnt alive. Thus, the freedom was extended a little bit. Next, there is a slide missing of auto da fe. Sorry, I have to yell at my assistant. This is long, last second. Next, a beautiful introduction of Christianity was Treuga Dei, or Pax Dei. Does that mean the peace of God or the truce of God? Well, what did that mean? The church didn't like Christians fighting. In fact, the church didn't like war much. Hence, St. Thomas Aquinas and his idea of just war. Since the church didn't like fighting, it tried to discourage Christian rulers from taking up their arms. And the church would make troubles. The church would say, you know, it's Saturday, Sunday's tomorrow. How are you going to show up at church if you're campaigning? Okay, so Saturday is a bad day. Friday, however, you fast. Why do you fast? Well, because you're rich. Poor people fast every day. If the rich don't fast on Friday, they don't know how the poor feel. So you shouldn't really take up your arms on Fridays. And then there was actually Tuesday and Thursday were the only days, finally, that was okay to move camp. It was okay to move camp. It was a wonderful device which limited warfare in Western Christendom to a bare minimum. It doesn't mean there were no battles. Human beings like to fight. It's in their nature. But they were gravely limited, and they were not encouraged. Next, you had Crusades, which qualified as the last wars. From my birthday on July 15th, 1099, when Crusaders took Jerusalem, until the day that my ancestors rode that horse and heavy cavalry to Vienna on September 11th, 1683, there had been plenty of crusades. Crusades were about accepting Western Christendom, among other things, and about speaking the truth about the Christian faith, as opposed to the Muslim faith. I will remind you that all of this was Christian. I was just in Turkey. Yes, the Syrian border is really troublesome. I was in Turkey, and I saw mosques at gas stations. Ataturk would be rolling in his coffin. I saw mosques in every village, fixed up. This is astonishing. This is simply astonishing. I know Westerners are post-Christian, so they don't care. They usually don't pay attention to anything like this. But secular Turkey is no more, at least in the countryside. The cities, that's a different story, but given a chance. Next thing that Christianity gave us in, oh, this is actually the most Christian ruler, this is St. Louis of France, was a royal who lived true to his name as a Christian king. Very many historians treat him as naive, but he forced himself to do that which was just, as opposed to do that which was pragmatic and Machiavellian. He insisted. And you know this story. One of the greatest English kings, mostly because he barely visited home. So he left you guys alone. And that's how the government should be. Unless you're in trouble, then the government intervenes, if it's your government. At any rate, so that's, can we click again? Yes. And here we have the jihad. Once the Spanish won the Reconquista, which, following the invitation in the 7th century, 8th century, of the Muslims to Spain by a Visigothic prince who was offended with his family, it took almost 800 years for the Reconquista. The Muslims stopped on the Pyrenees. There was one kingdom left, Christian kingdom, a tiny one, ruled by Pelayo. He was the last line of defense. If you have heard in your childhood Chanson de Roland, the song of Roland, that's about Pelayo and Charlemagne riding on a crusade against the Muslims. Once they were pushed out in 1492, and the last fortress, Granada, fell, another great Muslim power arrived on the scene. By that time it had captured Constantinople. The Byzantine Empire was no more. And by that time all of this, formerly Christian, was Muslim. The Muslims reached Vienna and the Carpathians. They fought with the Poles on and off. The Poles were very reluctant crusaders, but they did come out. One of the first major expeditions was at Varna in 1444. And a young Polish king, Ladislas XIV, who was Ladislas was 18, was killed at that crusade. It is said that he recklessly attacked the enemy. But the truth was that his allies deserted, and he was surrounded with a bodyguard of his Hungarian and Polish knights. So he looked around, and he made the only correct decision. There was no way out but to kill the Sultan. If you kill the Sultan in a patrimonial society, if you kill the head of a totalitarian regime, usually the whole thing falls apart. Just like you killed Hitler, and it was over. That's to those of you who think violence doesn't solve anything. I don't like violence, I don't like war, but sometimes that's the only thing you could do. So the Polish king ordered his knights to charge the Sultan. They made it within a spear's length, and then they ran out of steam. And he was killed, and so was everybody with him. His head was borne in a jar of honey around the Ottoman Empire to brag. There was another story like this in 1585, I think. Dom Sebastian, a 25-year-old king of Portugal, who was on a crusade. That's after the Battle of Mohacs. He was on a crusade in contemporary Morocco. He was surrounded by a huge Muslim army. He looked at his knights, who were very few and very thirsty in their armor, and he said, "Die, but slowly." And so they did. Here's another highlight, the Battle of Mohacs, when another Polish king, another Jagiellonian prince, was killed in battle to stop the onslaught of the Ottomans. And this is when the Habsburgs took over from the Poles. The Poles withdraw behind the defensive lines of the Carpathians, and Polish aggressive crusading was no more. It was mostly limited now to defensive battles, such as the Battle of Hodgin. Anyway, yeah, that's the Battle of Hodgin. I was in Rome, visiting with friends, and I took some, I love to take my American friends places, because America has had a very brief history. So I went to the Lepanto Foundation, where I have some friends, and my friends from over the pond asked the Italians, what was this, what that foundation was all about. And the Italians said, we know, we are the descendants of the knights who fought at Lepanto. Yes. Do you know who lost his hand at Lepanto, defending Western Christendom? Cervantes. Por Dios, por la patria y el rey y fueros. That was the war chant. That meant for God, the country, the king, and the local rights, fueros. It usually is omitted, but that was the full chant in Spain. So you have Lepanto as another example of the Crusades. Maya system loves those battles, that's why too many, and no Inquisition. At any rate, next thing, I think, here you have Sobieskie Wiemy. A few years ago, military intelligence declassified Osama bin Laden's sermons and translated them into the English. Guess why Osama picked September 11th? That's why, because the battle was joined on September 11th, 1683. Here in Great Britain, even if you didn't know that, you would not be very surprised that Osama remembers. In America, everybody was shocked, because nobody remembers anything in America. There's always tomorrow in America, no yesterday. Oblivion is bliss, especially about history. And next we have, so this is the last crusade, which checked, Lepanto checked westward expansion of the Ottomans, of the jihadists, and Vienna checked the very eastern and southern expansion, or northern expansion, I'm sorry. And next thing is all those ideas spread because of the voyages of discovery. The voyages of discovery were about gold, or gold and glory, driven very much not only by the faith, but also by greed and by romanticism. They all wanted to be knights. I don't know if you realize that Portugal's national epic is Luísa, which is modeled after the Odyssey and Homer. It's about Henry the Navigator's sailors. They love to celebrate that. Oh, at least the Portuguese who cared about their tradition. And thus Christianity spread with its ideas and institutions throughout the world, including introducing the germ of freedom in a very roundabout way. And here I would like to talk about Christian freedom, yes? Well, okay, let me flog the dead horse. When the Spaniards arrived in Mexico City, that's what they saw. It's on the worst day ever in Mexico City, 10,000 human beings were sacrificed. Truly, we shouldn't talk about the Spanish success. We should talk about the success of the Spanish allies, who were natives. They rose against their oppressors. I'll tell you how the sacrifice was performed. They would line up the captives, force them up the pyramid, then the priests would open up the chest cavity and rip out the heart and devour it in front of a screaming crowd and kick the body down. The Spaniards, when they saw it, were convinced, since the Aztec god was in the shape of a snake, they were convinced they saw Satan. This also has to be kept in mind. And I'm not telling you that the Spanish were fantastic, lovely, tolerant, open-minded, and from San Francisco. No. They were very brutal. But they thought they were fighting against Satan. And certainly, in a way, with that their native allies thought at first that would be an improvement. And in a way it was, because they were introduced to the religion of Jesus Christ, with all that entails. Okay. Now, if we can click, we are moving, before I talk about the move toward post-Christianity, I'd like to discuss two case studies, the Commonwealth case study and the English case study. They will not be, I will not start with England for a reason, but I'll get there. First I'll talk about the Polish study. A dozen or so years after the Magna Carta, the Poles introduced something called the Act of Cina, which encouraged the lords and the ecclesiasts, higher ecclesias, to participate in ducal councils in all provinces of medieval Poland. There had been councils called by the dukes, usually war councils made up of warriors, but this time the franchise was extended more to the lords. Concurrently, various rights were introduced by transplanting Magdeburg and Hanseatic urban legal devices onto the Polish lands. But those institutions, legal institutions and devices concerned burghers, not nobility. Nobility was encouraged to participate knights in local councils, and there was a trick. Anytime the king wanted a defensive war, the nobility, which in Poland constituted between 10% and 15%, I will talk about it in a second. The nobility would say, sorry dude, we won't go because no one's invading us and you want an offensive war and we don't want to pay taxes. So they get a tax break, various rights, collective rights, so their taxes will be lower. The Polish society in medieval times developed differently than elsewhere in Western Christendom. What was yeomanry? The Welsh longbowmen were yeomen, free farmers. In Poland were petty nobility with their coats of arms. The Dukes of Mazovia ennobled entire villages. That meant those people were free. 10% to 15% of the population, they were free. Except they had to fight. So if you're free, it doesn't come free. Freedom is not free. It comes for your bravery. This is the price. You fight. And that was the Polish nobility. And we're not there yet. If you can go back, because all the slides are gone. Yes. I can give you this email. He's safely tucked away in DC. Anyway, so you won't find anything, you have to go all the way, yes, right here. No. Go back where you were, too. Because I'll be. At any rate, one of the first devices the Poles introduced at the national level was an election of the king. I've already mentioned the Grand Duke of Lithuania marrying the 13-year-old king of Poland was Hedwig. And you should all know them, all the Brits, that is, English at least. Do you know what her name was? D'Anjou. Do you know what the name in England was? Plantagenet. That's the same family. She was the daughter of Lajos the Great, Louis the Great, the king of Hungary. And she was D'Anjou. She was a Plantagenet. So she was the king of Poland. Couldn't be the king of England because you guys had Salic law from the Germans. In Poland, no. So one of the first things was when the Grand Duke of Lithuania was tapped to become the co-king of Poland with his wife, also the king of Poland, this was an election. Eventually the elections became more formalized. It really had taken a long time. They became more formalized and the Poles began to elect their kings. It was a gradual path. Not only were there tax breaks for the nobility, but there were also other rights extended in 1436. The king, or actually the council and the parliament, introduced a new law. Neminem captivabimus. Who knows what that is? Habeas corpus, 150 years before the English thought about it. See, now I'm Greek. The Poles invented everything. Yes, 1436. That means you could not be arrested without a valid warrant and your property was safe. That's freedom. That's freedom, 1436. The next step is very popular in the United States of America. I tell my students in the US, who think there are only two great countries, Poland and the United States, in the world, so I tell them in 1505, the Poles, the parliament, introduced a new constitution. The constitution was called Nihil Novi. Do you know what that means? Well, here's the Polish the English translation of the Latin. Nothing new without us, about us. Do you know how to say it in American? No taxation without representation. And then the class perks up, wakes up. Yes, 1505. Before I will go on, I will let you gloat on it. Think about it. Be proud or jealous or whatever. I'll go back to 1413. When Poland entered into a personal union with the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, the Polish nobility boasted of many a right. They also had coat of arms. My family, which is from the province of Mstislav, that's beyond Smolensk, that was the last province of the Commonwealth. As my grandmother, who is ethnically Polish, who was ethnically Polish, used to say, you guys were on the trees wearing skins until the Poles civilized you. Yeah. So my family was uncivilized because we had no coats of arms. We were boyars of the Grand Dukes of Lithuania. So you know what the Poles did? The Poles extended their coats of arms, Polish nobility, to all Ruthenian and Lithuanian nobility. That's contemporary Latvia, Lithuania, Belarus, Ukraine, all about 200 miles away from Moscow. That's freedom. Because otherwise it would have been colonialism. And instead they said, here you go. You're equal now. You're free, just like we are. The Grand Dukes of Lithuania didn't like it too much because they liked the Mongol model, the patrimonial model. And the Poles introduced the West. They introduced Western Christendom to lands that had been pagan and Byzantine Christian with its Caesaropapism. The Grand Dukes of Lithuania, who were kings of Poland, took their sweet time before they extended the same courtesy to their own subjects in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania that they had to constitutionally uphold in the Crown of Poland. And the lords of the Grand Duchy, which stretched almost to the Black Sea, didn't much like that nobility, meaning the knights, demanded rights. Because in Moscow, everybody was a slave and everybody was fine with that. Wasn't one. At any rate, the Commonwealth was also peculiar because of its tolerance. I don't know if throughout its hundreds of years of history, more than 7 witches were burned. I know of one instance, a Protestant sect called the Judaizers was punished and 3 or 4 people were burned in Krakow, then a few in Tom. We're talking here 400 years, while in Western Europe, the Christendom was no more. Christians were killing each other in the name of Christ because some were Protestants, others were Catholic. The Protestants were also killing each other. You know, competition to who could pray best. Upon hearing that Catholic fanatics massacred the Protestants of Paris, Huguenots, I believe it was night of August 23rd, 1571 or 72, the night of Saint Bartholomew, the Parliament in Warsaw, a majority Catholic country with a huge Orthodox Christian, Byzantine Christian plurality, and a big chunk of Protestants, both Calvinists and Lutherans, as well as some anti-Trinitarian sects, the Parliament in Warsaw passed a new law called the Confederation of Warsaw, which guaranteed freedom of religion to everyone. By this I mean not only Protestants, Catholics of course, but not only Protestants of all denominations, but also Jews and Muslims. Why? Because there were Polish Tatars in the Commonwealth, and some of them were nobility, so they voted. This, ladies and gentlemen, is true tolerance, not pretend tolerance of political correctness, because they were all citizens of the Commonwealth, and those who were nobility had to fight. So, at the Battle of Vienna, we had Tatar Muslim contingents fighting against our freedom. Earlier, some 80 years ago, a couple of Tatar squadrons deserted the Polish army, and they promptly redefected back to Poland because they said, when we reported before the Turks, they started treating us like slaves. And in Poland, we were nobility. So, of course, they returned. You can be a Muslim within the Christian framework, and it's very hard to be a Christian within the Muslim framework. Just ask anybody from Egypt. You're reduced to tending pigs and picking up garbage. That's not how Polish Muslims were. That's why they were loyal. In America, we study Polish Muslims because almost everybody in America is shocked how things are turning out in Great Britain and France and elsewhere. And why were things so great in Poland, in the Commonwealth? Okay, so this is the Commonwealth of my dreams, and let's go very quickly to England. And England is more important because it became a world power. The Commonwealth was a regional power. The nobility didn't like offensive war, so they didn't like to fight. They didn't like to go. They were isolationists in a way, and also autarkic. They thought, everybody has his farm, his estate, let's hang out, take it easy, why should we go anywhere? The English, however, superseded the Spanish as the great world power. So they spread their ideas around the world. And many of the institutions, whether one wants to admit it or not, including the necktie, which comes from Kavat when Napoleon went to Croatia, but many of the institutions and mores are English throughout the world. Not only in Africa, but in Japan, too. They emulated the best all over the world. And they picked up things that they liked, discarded others. And most people in the world have no idea that those things come from England. England developed differently. A very good maritime historian, Padfield, who is an old crusty reactionary, an old Brit, who loves the colonial times and loves Mahan and sea power, thought that he discovered the key to freedom when he described the British way, namely individual commercial effort translates into innovation, translates into wealth, translates into new technologies, and translates into rights. So a merchant could sail on his own dhow, unimpeded by the government, blessed by the government oftentimes, would have enough money to improve his ship, to improve the sailing technique, to improve the equipment. And many merchants could muster a fleet if England was in trouble. This is the British model of freedom. They demanded rights because they became wealthier, and more rights were granted to them. Not so much in Spain. In Spain or in France, the state was perfectly capable of pulling all the resources together, to create grand fleets once. And if the fleet screwed up, like the Grand Armada, or the fleets off of the off of Trafalgar, that was it. The English, even if they were defeated, had the talent, because the talent was freedom. So Padfield argues that, hey, this is uniquely English, and that's why we have freedom in England, in America, and everybody else sucks. I make my students read Padfield. And they are all very happy because they're Americans. And American heritage, everything that's great about Great Britain. That's why it only took Margaret Thatcher to put Great back into Britain. See, before Thatcher, all of this was gone. At any rate, if you look at the English way, it is, the English way of freedom is peculiar to England, but it is not the only way. So I torment my students, I say, well, Padfield argues that freedom is tied inexorably to maritime power. What about Switzerland? And then they are stunted. And if I want to torment them more, then I talk to them about Novgorod the Great, which was a great Ruthenian city outside of the boundaries of the Commonwealth, which already in the 11th century sported a mixed constitution, oligarchic and democratic, elected its own princes who served as commanders-in-chief and nothing else, and had a big bell 700 years before Philadelphia, the freedom bell in Philadelphia. So there are various paths to freedom. The English path is just the most popular, famous, for it's impacted everything else. Now let's look at the English way very quickly. We all talk about the Magna Carta. The Magna Carta was a trick. It was not a joke, but it was a trick. First, a trick by the barons, by the lords, who tricked the king. And then a trick by the king, who agreed to it when he didn't mean to. And then it went into hibernation. Until the Glorious Revolution. So when the English say, ah, the Magna Carta, yeah. It took a very long time for freedom to realize itself on this island. A very long time. Not until the Glorious Revolution, with a detour for a horrible revolution and civil war. Only God saved England from such freaks as the Fifth Monarchy men. You don't know what it is, look it up. I won't tell you, it's another legend. I don't know if you'll invite me afterwards, but the Fifth Monarchy men were proto-Bolsheviks related to the Cathars and Albigensians intellectually. So, the English crept towards freedom. And when they were ready to spread their wings, Western Christendom had entered its post-Christian phase. The post-Christian phase was a paradigm shift which commenced with the Protestant Revolution. The objective of the revolution was to destroy the Catholic Church. So it was not a reformation. We had a Catholic Reformation. The Protestant Revolution was led by Martin Luther and others who wanted to destroy the Church. That's a revolution. The Catholics responded with counter-revolution, trident. This was also in defense of freedom. Both sides thought it was in defense of freedom. The English intellectuals, or actually Scottish too, no offense, by the middle of the 18th century, had developed a new paradigm to replace the old Christian paradigm that we're all children of God, therefore we have dignity and freedom. They had come up with an idea that God was a great clockmaker and he set up the world, stepped aside, and lets things run, just looks on more or less keenly. God as the great clockmaker. Well, that's totally anti-Christian. Jesus Christ is involved in everything in the world. If you're a Christian, that's a Christian belief. If you're a deist, you think he's a clockmaker. This is when the invisible hand made its appearance. But the invisible hand can only be successful if it's constrained in its predatory practices by a Christian framework. If you'd like to see capitalism, so-called capitalism at work, in its unadulterated form, unconstrained by anything, I'll take you to China. It's state capitalism of the communists. A so-called Enlightenment made its appearance too, with the Great Terror and the Revolution in France. The goddess of reason was contrasted with Christianity. Blood flew, but not in England. In England, despite everything, freedom took on the best shape at that time, the best shape possible. Namely, since the English came to dominate the world, it was not the 19th century yet, but the foundation had been laid. Suddenly, out of power and prosperity, a reflection arose. People like John Wesley, the Methodists, said slavery is an abomination. If we as Englishmen are free, we should shed the grace of God, freedom, on those we touch upon who became our subjects. At first he was the freak, but people like Edmund Burke, the father of modern conservatism, chimed in and said freedom was an absolute. It must obtain. He even supported the Poles. He even supported the Polish written constitution of May 3rd, even though he hated any constitution that was written if it was not written in the heart. But he understood that this was constitution of May the 3rd, 1791, was an attempt to codify the tradition of the Commonwealth in a modern form. But slavery, in whatever form, and the English dealt mostly with African slavery, was an abomination. It took some time. Gradually, it was abolished. William Wilberforce was a powerful voice in the Parliament. Even Prime Minister Pitt supported it. And once the mightiest nation in the world, England, abolished slavery. Once the Royal Navy started raiding slave ships, slavery quickly was no more. And as I said, throughout human history, slavery has been with us until this very day. And for some reason, against one's economic best interest, because it was great to have slaves in the Caribbean, it didn't matter that 3/4 of them died within 3 years, but they were producing sugar cane, whatever else the slavers wanted. Human cargo was great. And the English said no. Why? Why did they love freedom so much if it was not congruent with their economic interests? Where is Marx? Where is Professor Holzman? In hell. But that's another story. Ladies and gentlemen, the English did freedom the greatest service through lobbying here at the grassroots. The Methodists and then the Baptists, not Church of England. Slavery was abolished and exterminated throughout the world. This is the greatest contribution to freedom by the English people. You have no idea. The Greeks have nothing on the English. If I were a woman, I'd rather be a Spartan than an Athenian. Not only in Athens would I not be able to vote, I was ghettoized as a woman. I couldn't go on the street alone. The Spartan babes, until 15, they were getting a Navy SEAL training, special forces training. Why? Because the dudes were gone on war and women running things. So I'd be a Spartan woman. Once again, the English were the best. And what do we do with this now? If you can hit the last one, because I'll never end, my assistant wanted me to talk for 3.5 hours to you. And I could. I'm getting paid for my hobby. Not here, this is pro bono. But I could. If you hit the last one on the... Yeah, last, very last one. So I'm not going to go through all this. Talk about syllabus of error and liberalism. And Pope Leo XIII, forget about it. Oh, yes. All the way down, yes. Nazis, communists, national socialists and international socialists. But now I'll spare you this because I made a promise that we can all get drunk. Those of us who can or want to. This is what we have to deal with. Christianity and postmodernism. What do we do now? Well, if you meet a post-structuralist, and she or he tells you there's no truth, nothing matters, then you propose that you will deconstruct that person's house with a bulldozer and see how that feels and whether an absence of a house is the truth. That's all. All we have to do in the modern world is stay true to ourselves, to be free. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. As you said in the beginning, we have time for a couple of questions before we go to a more informal part of the meeting, where people will have a chance to speak with the Professor. We have a list here. If you'll be interested to be informed about the further future lectures, please leave your name on the list. And as well, for those of you who can speak and read Polish, Professor's books are available for sale just outside the door. So if anybody would like a question,
my books in English are on Amazon.com. They're very thick and boring. Because I'm a historian. Many footnotes.
They're quite interesting, actually. So, would you have any questions? You could be stand up because we have no.
I have a question. Well, thank you very much. Fascinating lecture. Story, tour de force, through history, millennia.
A shortcut.
Yes, of course, that would intend to be a shortcut. My question is possibly a slightly provocative question, or maybe a challenging question. Yes, slavery has been abolished, extinguished, disappeared. However, I would suggest that freedom as such still remains a rather abstract notion, totally abstract notion. In philosophical terms and even personal terms. And it's very much related to economic status, to the economic ambiance, to the political pressures. So freedom as an individual, as the individual rather, is very, very severely limited. Only because of our political correctness, which might have been born earlier because before the term itself had been coined, forces us to say, yes, freedom does exist, slavery doesn't. Well, is it true? Isn't it the other round? Haven't we, are we not losing our freedom
today? I didn't say slavery did not exist. In fact, I teach a seminar called Mass Murder in Failed States, and we deal with slavery. We deal with types like Joseph Kony, who kidnaps children for sex as porters and as toy soldiers. Slavery exists. Don't take me wrong. It's just not sexy anymore. And we fight against it. And as far as your observation about freedom and the way it's fulfilled, you're absolutely right. In America, we joke that the only people who are truly free are homeless, gazillionaires, and tenured professors. Because they can't be fired. My school doesn't have tenure. And I'm the only nobody, I don't have a security clearance. I can't tell you anymore because I would have to commit suicide. It's a secret.
There's one more question in the back, please.
Mm-hmm. So, If I were a Muslim, a British Muslim, presumably I would say things that the Muslim religion itself brings or encourages freedoms. What would you say?
I would ask you to quote the surah.
No, I don't know. I'm not a Muslim.
Okay,
well. I'm inviting you to say, what would Muslims say about freedom?
I'm not Muslim. I've read the Quran and I've studied several Muslim empires, from India to the Salafid and the Ottoman Empire, as well as the Caliphate, not only because of the Crusades, but I also teach a seminar on comparative civilizations, so I would like to know. But I don't know I don't know Arabic. That's my handicap. From what we get in translation is usually, but not always, from forms very hostile to the Muslim world, in particular the Middle East. Not so much what we get from Indonesia or Malaysia. That's still different. But the coverage of the Middle East, including intellectual coverage, does not allow me to be confident enough to take on a persona of a Muslim to defend Muslims. But from what I've read the Quran, not in the original, I've read it in English, and I've read some of the commentaries. I remember there is one of the most popular books in the United States, The Sword of the Prophet, written by Sirja Trifković, who's a Serb. So he rips into the Muslims. And I make my students read not only Trifković, I make him read Albert Kurani, who's an Oxford don, and he's very measured, although he mirror images. Trifković exaggerates, and Kurani mirror images to try to make Islam compatible with Western civilization, so we would be comfortable studying it. It's sort of like Niki Sohanne, who wrote Bushido, the Code of the Samurai. And he explained it to Christians by invoking images of Aristotle, Nietzsche, and Dostoevsky, etc., so that Westerners, when he wrote that book in 1907, he had 5 doctorates from the West, that particular Japanese scholar. It almost reads like a Western tract, Bushido. Until you get to a point where they tell you to, after you decapitate your enemy, to preserve the head, you have to urinate on it. Sort of hard to reconcile with the genius of Christianity. So, to restate, I cannot be advocatus diaboli, I'm not qualified. Maybe if there is a Muslim in the room, or somebody who knows Muslim civilization, like Lawrence of Arabia, may Lawrence stand up and tell me where the elements of love and elements of freedom are contained. Because I couldn't find any in Moses Maimonides. I also don't read Hebrew, but I have read his translation without any lacuna, and it's shocking. Shocking. For instance, from this and other sources, they found out that an Orthodox, ultra-Orthodox now, but there were only, until the Haskalah movement, there were only ultra-Orthodox among the Jewish. So they used to pray every day, God, thank you for not making me a woman or a cockroach. This is a morning prayer. But that's comparative civilizations, so I'll never be invited here anymore, because everybody gets offended. Have you noticed how the West has lost its sense of humor?
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's, I think, crippling. Crippling. Sorry.
And there also, we have a time just for last question. Just have another back, please.
You spoke about Suarez and the religious international order in the 15th century. I was wondering, to what extent do you believe that the establishment of and upholding of an international legal order in the 21st century can maintain the freedoms that everyone in every individual automatically has?
There is a fantastic essay by late Professor Kenneth Watts of Columbia University called Anarchy in International Order. Because there is anarchy in international order. If you eliminate anarchy, Because it's very logical, you know, we all want order, peace and love, global government, blah, 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 some of us at least, blah, blah, blah. Then what's going to happen is the top position will be so coveted to eliminate anarchy and impose order that it invites a world civil war. So, a decentralized system, perhaps some kind of an agreement. You know, I like the English way also. I mean, I didn't have time to talk about the face of English imperialism, but the English liked the trade to precede the flag, and they were reluctant imperialists. Those European powers that like the state first, like the Spanish and the French, introduced some kind of an autarky. For instance, the Caribbean islands in Latin America were charged, the markup was sometimes 300-400% on products that could have been obtained much, 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 much cheaper through free trade because of centralization. So I am rather skeptical. Kenneth Waltz, a very good essay, it's very theoretical. I hate theory, I fall asleep because I'm an empirical scholar, logocentric scholar. I like to hit the archives, but he was one of the very few at Columbia that made sense, even if he used theory. Yes. I hope that helps.
Unfortunately, sorry, we don't have time for any more questions. There'll be time to speak to the professor now in the outside over the glass of wine. Thank you very much, professor, for a very interesting lecture. Thank you very much to the organizing this lecture. And please join us for a glass of wine.
Yeah, there's some wine outside. As I mentioned, there's a voluntary contribution. The wine can be brought back in here. There isn't a lot of room out there, but I should probably be doling it out with the aid of one or two friends. So, thank you very much for something as a sort of an intellectual discussion, not a discussion, intellectual presentation, such as I've not really heard since I left university some half a century ago. So, thank you very much indeed, and I think we should think ourselves very fortunate to have such an erudite presentation with a Polish slant here in Antwerp. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.